Good morning, everyone. Happy Sunday. And welcome to another worship here at the United Church of Dorset and East Rupert. We dearly appreciate that you let us into your homes and into your hearts for worshiping together this Sunday. May the peace and the love of the Lord be with us all. Let me begin with a few announcements to the church family this morning. We are delighted to receive the lovely flowers from Joanne Limbacher in thanks for family and friends. We continue our stewardship build-up to our annual Pledge Sunday, which is next Sunday. This week, we're going to be focusing on love of neighbor, and you will note in your bulletin that a wonderful piece was provided by Ginny Longacre. And later in this morning's service, Bill Bridges, representing the Stewardship Committee, will offer an important perspective. We want to let everyone know what a marvelous success the Free Church Supper was this last Wednesday evening, sponsored by the deacons. They served over 117 dinners. Keep your eyes peeled for the next Free Church Supper that will be provided by the Fellowship sometime in November. Next Wednesday at 5 o'clock, we will resume in church Bible study down in the vestry, thanks to the new HEPA filters that are constantly circulating and refreshing the air. I urge people to bring their own Bible, and Esther and I will provide soup and bread. And as I said, next Sunday is Pledge Sunday, and so there will not be tent worship outside, only video worship, because it is our tradition to include three wonderful testimonials to inspire us to our pledging. And so they will be part of our video worship experience. So the Sunday after Halloween, November 1st, is known throughout Christendom as All Souls Sunday, the time when we remember how lively the spirits of our departed loved ones are in our lives. In honor of that, I wore my clan tartan tie from my Scottish ancestors, and I splashed on my aftershave given to me by my father-in-law, who was a barber, and I always splash that on and say to myself, "Papa, be with me this day." We all have this undying attachment to our loved ones. So as we worship this day, let us feel the closeness of their spiritual heritage and the importance of the God that we worship in common. Let us join our hearts, our minds, and our souls this day as we worship God. Friends, shall we call one another to worship this day? The psalmist sings, "Oh, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me.
Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling.
Then I will go to the altar of God, to God with my exceeding joy.
And I will praise you with the harp, O God, my God."
Thank you.
Friends, will you join me in our unison prayer of invocation? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Shall we all pray? Merciful and faithful God, you sent to us your Son, who teaches us the ways of righteousness and brings us into your presence, forgiven and restored. Open our hearts, our ears, our minds to your nourishment by word and sacrament, that we might willingly obey and believe. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And shall we join together in the words of our Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
You will see that we have included this Sunday in our bulletin a moment for stewardship. And so I welcome Bill Bridges, who is an ardent member of our stewardship committee, to give us a perspective that will inspire and educate us as we next Sunday make our pledges to support financially the ministry that we share together here at the Dorset Church. I welcome Bill Bridges.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Bill Bridges with the Stewardship Committee with a reminder that next Sunday is Pledge Sunday. So that's a time of year has come again. The time when we must really sit down at our tables and do our budgeting and decide how much we want to give to the Dorset Church. Last year, we had 117 pledging units, about the same number as the year before, and we did meet the dollar estimates that the Budget Committee had asked. So, of these loyal and regulars, we ask that you continue your membership and faithfulness to the church, and if possible, consider increasing your gift a little bit. That would be just wonderful. But I need to say something inspirational, which might light the spark of pledging in the many loving and hardworking hearts out there who are loyal to the Dorset Church, but who haven't yet seen the need for they themselves to pledge. So my inspirational word for them is, wait for it, participation. For those of you who have not pledged before, consider starting small and comfortable, but be part of the overall team. That would be great. Thank you for your attention.
Please join with me in our prayer of pastoral care. Let us pray. All thanks and praise be to you, most holy God, giver of life. You made us for companionship and shaped us for love. You gave us your good earth and taught us to care. You established your law that we might learn justice and give you honor with our lives. Let us pray for the needs of the world, saying, hear our cries, O Lord, grant us your aid. For your church in this land and around the world, in its faithfulness and in its brokenness, hear our cries, O Lord, grant us your aid. For this country's election, may all be able to vote safely and justly, that democracy may respond to the better angels of our nature. Hear our cries, O Lord, grant us your aid. For all who teach and those who would learn, keep them safe and supported in their common tasks. Hear our cries, O Lord, grant us your aid. And for all who are sick or dying, for all who suffer from the pandemic, and those who care for them, and in silence let us think of the people for whom we would pray. Hear our cries, O Lord, grant us your aid. We now lift before you, O God, those on this church's prayer list. We pray for baby James and Jane and Ched Evans, for Andrew Leeds and Doris Ibbotson, for Mary Abbott Ludke, for Terry Archard and Tyler Kennedy. We pray, O God, for Frank, for Jameson Gray Pelton, for Betsy LaVecchia, for Vern James, for Audrey Brass. Hear our prayers for Martha Bowen, for Carl Hedman, for Mary Deo, and Henry Croft. We pray for Evan Barbaris and Barbara West, for Hayward Day and Dick and Linda Buswell. We pray for Susan Reese, for Mackenzie Cahill, for Andrew Altman, for Nate and Allie Webster. Hear our prayers, O God, for Kenny and the Kunish family, for Linda and Peter Salmon, for Adam, Aaron, Emma, and Jonah, for Richard White, for Rand Snyderman, and Sandy Carey. We pray, O God, for Claire and Jackie and Mike, for Aaron Pixley Thurston and Ed Shirowski, for Diane and Chip Wilson, for Gary Dufour and Zaina Perry. We pray for, lift up in prayer our prayers for Cheryl Hazelton, for Desiree Hazelton, for Crystal Madison, for Vicki Houston and Sally Weichert. We pray for Harry Boynton and Kurt Trombetic and Dolores. And in the Dorset Church, we pray for the Serve Committee for their upcoming alternative gift fair that will be held this coming Saturday outdoors, under the tents. And we pray in our Vermont conference for our friends at the United Church of West Rutland. And in the United Church of Christ, our national and international denomination. We pray for the Southern New England Conference that has abolished $26.2 million in medical debt for families in seven states, as well as for many first responders around the country. O God, we join with all the saints on earth and all the angels in heaven in giving all thanks and praise, that that praise and thanks may be to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Of Mamre, as he sat by his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing nearby. He ran and greeted them. "My lords, if I find your favor, do not pass by me, your servant. Let water be brought and wash your feet and rest under the tree. And likewise bread, that you may refresh yourselves." They responded, "Do as you have said." So Abraham told Sarah, his wife, to quickly make ready three cakes of the choicest flour. And Abraham ran to his herd and killed a tender calf and had it prepared. Then he took milk curds, and all was set before these strangers as they rested under the tree. They said to Abraham, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife shall bear a son." Now Abraham and Sarah were so advanced in age and unable to bear children that Sarah laughed to herself inside the tent. And later Sarah bore a son and named him Isaac, which means laughter. And Abraham was 100 years old when Isaac was born. Hebrews 13. Let mutual love continue. Never neglect to show hospitality to strangers. For by doing so, some have entertained angels unawares.
We dearly thank Tracy Salmon for giving us our scripture reading so fervently for this Sunday. And let it be our prayer that the words from the sacred text might become the word of God in our lives. Before I offer the sermon entitled Our Better Angels, let us pray. O God of love, O God of truth, let us say strong things gently and gentle things strongly. Let us speak the truth in love to all, and love the truth that lives in each. Let us hear the truth as we each need it and live that truth. O God, we heed it through Jesus, your word and our Lord. Amen.
Time out. Sorry. Is that rain outside or is that the air?
It's the air.
I think that's the air.
Is there any way to turn that off?
I don't know how to.
I know Jane does, but I don't know how to do it. She goes back here or something.
Is it the one that you hear right there? I don't think it's... I think she goes...
Or are those the new... I mean, it's like not the end of the world. I mean, it's not the end of the... Yeah, I don't think there's anything here.
It's not these things.
No.
There's something here that may be newer.
Yeah, I don't know if we dare fiddle with it.
Yeah, we'll just deal with it. I mean, it's just kind of like a...
Shall I speak up?
Turn it off?
No,
I don't want to mess with anything. Somebody's going to have to reprogram it or something, you know?
Oh! Skip! Okay. Magic, man. Thanks, Skip.
Okay.
Awesome.
Just turn it into something that's more like sure, you know?
Do I need to redo anything?
Maybe from that last part, like the very this whole.
When
last,
I come back in and thank Tracy?
Okay. Might as well.
Okay, yeah, not a problem. Not a problem. We thank Tracy Salmon for our excellent reading of Scripture this day. And let it be our prayer that the words from the sacred text might become the word of God in our lives. Before I offer my sermon this morning entitled Our Better Angels, shall we pray? O God of love, O God of truth, let us say strong things gently and gentle things strongly. Let us speak the truth in love to all, and love the truth that lives in each. Let us hear the truth as we each need it and live that truth. O God, we heed it through Jesus, your word and our Lord. Amen. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strained, it must not break our bonds of affection. The mystic cords of memories, stretching from every battlefield and patriot grave, to every living heart and hearthstone all over this broad land, will yet swell the chorus of the Union, when again touched, as surely they will be, by the better angels of their nature. These are the words from the greatest Republican in American history, Abraham Lincoln, as he closed his first presidential inaugural address in March of 1860. Just days later, the Civil War began. Did our better angels not hear him? Were they not listening? First, let us think about civil wars. America has had one major civil war fought with armies and violence that killed 618,222 citizens, the greatest loss of American life in our history. And sadly, in some obvious ways, that civil war is still being fought. Oh, where are our better angels? But I think we have had other civil wars too. In my own lifetime, I remember the late 60s and early 70s, and our country was torn apart by the Vietnam War and President Nixon and Watergate. And like in many civil wars, it tore families apart too. I know it divided my own family. My Grammy and Grandpa Gray hardly spoke to our family throughout the entire time of Watergate. And then when Nixon's secret tapes went public, they suffered a civil war of their own soul between their personal politics and their own sense of decency. But slowly but surely, America did appeal to its better angels, and we healed, and we learned, and we moved forward. And now we are engaged in yet another civil war. And the upcoming election threatens to magnify it. Some welcome this civil war, even inflame it. But others are deeply afraid of it and, like Abraham Lincoln, pray for healing and reconciliation that our better angels might bring. And the burning question of faith and spirituality is this: how do we meet our better angels and receive their blessing? In this regard, our Bible story this morning begs to be heard. Now, the version of the Bible that Tracy read so nicely makes it sound like Abraham and Sarah were visited by regular human beings. But Jewish tradition holds that Yahweh sent angels to visit them. And through that visit, Abraham and Sarah were blessed with the birth of their first son, Isaac. Now, Jewish and Christian tradition sees this story as a paradigm for how to entertain angels unawares. So first, it is important to know when they visit. And the story of Abraham and Sarah tells us the time: in the heat of the day. Friends, angels draw near when times are heated. And we certainly live in heated times now, do we not? Political passions are hot. National speech is inflamed. People's anger burns hotly. And all this notifies us that our better angels are drawing near to us right now. Secondly, it is important to know how to expect them. And the story of Abraham and Sarah tells us. And Abraham looked up and saw three strangers standing there. Friends, angels come in the form of strangers. In the last handful of years, I have heard more times than I can count people say with utter incomprehension, I cannot believe my fellow Americans believe this. I can't believe people act this way. I can't believe we have come to this. Americans have become strangers to one another. I know I feel this way. I thought I knew my fellow Americans. I thought I knew my neighbors. I thought I knew my own religion of Christianity. I thought I knew my own family members. Heck, at times, I've even felt like a stranger unto myself. The other day, I got caught up in a shouting match with some guy in a store over masks. At an outdoor wedding a couple of months ago, I was ambushed by some guy from Texas who debated me on religious freedom because the wedding wasn't held inside our church. We had quite a verbal duel. The divisions that we have sown in our country have seeped into the American soul, and we have become strangers to one another, and strangers even perhaps to ourselves. And so we know, because this is the condition, that our better angels are even now drawing near. Thirdly, it is important to know how we should meet and greet them. And the story of Abraham and Sarah tells us. So Abraham ran and greeted them. My lords, if I find your favor, do not pass by me, your servant. Let water be brought and wash your feet and rest under the tree. And likewise bread, that you may refresh yourselves. And they responded, do as you have said. Abraham's first instinct was to offer these strangers hospitality. If anyone wishes to meet and greet their better angels, they must be hospitable to strangers and strangeness. For America right now, I see this to mean that we must openly meet our division. We must learn to listen and more honestly understand who this stranger is to us and why. We must not keep our spiritual strangeness at bay, but we must meet it and greet it and learn from it, and even learn about ourselves and our gods in the process. Right now, it seems to me that American society is increasingly a collection of ghettos. Bunches of non-strangers are banding together to live, to think, to entrench, and protect themselves from the outside world of strangers. That old saying that we taught our little children, stranger danger, has become the motto for many Americans of all ages. And so, if that is the condition, thus we know that our better angels are drawing near and they are awaiting our hospitality. But Abraham doesn't stop with hospitality. He goes even further. Bake cakes with our choicest flour. Kill the tender calf of the herd. Provide the cream of our milk. After hospitality, a generosity and power of grace is called for. In these heated and civil war times, our better angels are calling us to graciousness, to turn stranger into friend, offering your most generous in their time of need. When Abraham did this to those strangers, he was obediently following a deeply rooted code of hospitality that was revered by nearly all ancient tribes and people at that time. When a stranger in need enters your campground, you show them your very best greeting and your finest graciousness. Not because it's a rule, but because someday you will be in their place. What goes around shall come around. And so at the end of their visit, those angels blessed Abraham and Sarah with a miracle, the miracle of new life. And friends, doesn't our nation right now dearly need the new life that our better angels can bestow? In closing, I love the fact that there is a bit of confusion between those visitors to Abraham and Sarah. Were they ordinary people or visiting angels? And I wonder if that confusion is on purpose, that God calls us as ordinary people to become and take on the mission of our better angels. And so in this regard, I want to close with a poem I wrote a long time ago entitled Angels Among Us. When speaking of angels, what comes to mind? Perhaps winged beings of mythical kind, reminding we humans what's wrong and what's right, and flitting above us with halos so bright. Or naked they are, in divine innocence, like bare-bottomed putti without a pretense. Still other angels are fashioned from creeds known as defenders of God's righteous deeds, champion angels, armed for crusade, fighting off evil with faith unafraid. Onward against dragons and minions from hell, like Michael the angel or brave Gabriel. Then there are angels, as many contend, who meet us and greet us at our mortal end. At St. Peter's gates, made of gold and of pearl, welcoming us into heavenly worlds. But if in the Bible we were to scan the likes of dear Sarah or great Abraham, angels appear in a far different way. They stroll into life in the heat of the day, arriving in time with a mission of worth, bearing God's blessing of new life on earth. They enter as strangers with humanity, bearing resemblance of you and of me, garbed quite plainly in regular things, not saintly robes wearing halos and wings. They come a-knocking on one's humble door, looking for welcome, some room and some board. Greeting so warmly in home and in heart, they leave a miracle after they part. And so in this light, as our scriptures declare, you may meet angels and be unaware. Someone who meets you on journey of life and gifts you with healing in suffering and strife. Leaving behind them God's grace and surprise might have been angels, but not recognized. And even you, by fate's happenstance, may find you've arrived in the midst of a chance to share of your choicest and generous grace and be unto them an angelic embrace. So friends, let us heed what this wisdom declares. The angel in all of us must live well prepared. Amen.
One cup of
Friends, I welcome us all to share in this sacrament of Holy Communion, and I urge you to look to your bulletin for our order of worship, and also to have near at hand your bread and your cup so that I might consecrate them when it comes time in our service. But first and foremost, before anything else, I invite every single person partaking in this video worship to share in this sacrament of Holy Communion. Whether you're a member of the Dorset Church or not, or our denomination, or whether you're here joining us confident about your relationship with your Lord, or you might be going through a time of doubt and of questioning. Whether we're young or old, we are all God's children, and we are all invited by His majesty of love with gracious words such as this: ask, and it shall be given to you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened unto you. Let us begin this sacred moment, this sacrament, in a spirit and prayer of confession. Most loving God, we confess that we have seen much pain without being moved to compassion. We have begged forgiveness from others while hoarding our own charity. We've gathered our own tranquility at the expense of peace for others and creation. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy upon us. Amen. And as we have confessed, let us equally embrace God's love and forgiveness, for ours is a merciful God, bounteous in love. And when we strive to repent, in other words, to turn our lives back toward God, forgiveness is ours. This is God's promise to humanity through Christ our Lord. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God praise and thanks.
Therefore, with all the communion of saints, we also praise.
Holy, 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 God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory.
Friends, lift up your bread and your cup for this prayer of consecration. O God, consecrate this bread and wine that we may feed on things divine, drink from grapes and food from flour, fill them with thy holy power. Thus our Lord may present be, now and for eternity. Amen. And so we are greeted by the story that gives meaning to these simple elements. It is the story of that Last Supper that Jesus shared with his closest disciples as they gathered in fear and anxiety in that upper room on the night before Jesus was crucified. It was on the night that he was betrayed that he said this prayer of blessing: Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lachem min hashamayim borei pri hagafen. And then he took the bread and he broke it and he said, this is my body broken for you. As often as you eat this, do so in remembrance of me. Ministering to you in Jesus' name, let us eat of the body of Christ. And then Jesus took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, shed for you out of my love for you. As often as you drink this, do so in remembrance of me." So, ministering to you in Jesus' name, let us drink from the cup of the new covenant in Christ's blood. And shall we close this sacrament with hearts filled with thanksgiving and this unison prayer? We thank you, God, for inviting us to this table where we may experience Christ and receive his gifts. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and let us show forth your praise in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, today and forevermore. Amen.